Call all fundamentalists as good or all fundamentalists as bad.
Fundamentalism is the strict adherence to orthodox religious beliefs and traditions.
Maybe he's referring to an old edition of Oxford Dictionary, I don't blame him. But according to the latest edition of Oxford Dictionary, it says that fundamentalism means strictly adhering to the ancient or fundamental principles or doctrines of any religion, especially Islam.
I'm a religious person, but I'm not a fundamentalist in any sense of the word.
I'm proud and I'm happy to be a fundamentalist Muslim.
These three things, I think, are important in our own context. Firstly, an interpretation of the scriptures.
Apparently, the problem seems to be that every religion has a book.
Secondly, a dialogue with other opinions, even if you don't agree with those other opinions.
Islam allows interpretation of the scriptures, and Islam also allows a dialogue. You cannot make any changes in the revelation of God Almighty and in the Sahih Hadith. You cannot make any changes in the Quran or in the Sahih Hadith. But where it comes to Islam, the Sharia law, if the Quran does not mention about that particular problem, or if the Sahih Hadith does not mention that particular problem, you have to get an ijma, ijtihad. You have to get a common gathering of the learned people, and you can pass a new resolution.
We cannot have the question and answer session. There are a couple of rules to be observed. The speakers will have to stand up, identify themselves, and give the name of their publication. Because I expect a fusillade of questions, I think it should be one question per person. The question preferably should be directed to one particular speaker. And as I mentioned before, please be brief and do not try to give the answer to your own question. That should be left to the four eminent gentlemen who enlightened us to a great detail. So, fire away. Yeah.
My name is Javed, and I'm not from any publication. I just happened to read your advertisement in Times of India, and I thought I'll spend a good afternoon here. In any case, my question is directed to Mr. Dr. Zakir Naik. But before that, I want to clarify a point said by Mr. Sahani, who said that Taslima has been quoted wrongly. In any case, if you could see the 31st January 94 Time magazine issue reported by Mr. Fazan Ahmad, there she has said that the sun revolves around the earth. Okay, and I mean, how can we believe such unscientific thing if it is in the Quran? And secondly, she has blamed Islam for the high rate of female infanticide in Bangladesh. I mean, I think these are... Is it in the Quran? Can you clarify?
Brother Javed has posed me two questions. Depends upon the chairperson whether he allows me to answer both or not. I will answer the...
He has the beginner's luck. So he has asked two questions. In future it won't be permitted. Only one question.
The first question he said was in the Time magazine, which happens to be one of the most authentic magazine in the world. I do agree it was reported on the 31st of January that she said that Quran mentions that the sun revolves around the earth. And if we believe in such teachings, how can we progress? I do agree with the second statement. If we believe in such statements, how will we progress? But regarding the first part of the allegation, that the Quran mentions that the sun revolves around the earth, I want proof. Qul hatu burhanakum. Let her produce a proof. Where does the Quran say that? What she is referring to, brother, is mainly a verse in the Quran. In Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 33, which says, Huwa alladhi khalaqa al-layla wa al-nahara wa ash-shamsa wal-qamara kullun fi falakin yasbuhun. that it is Allah who has created the night and the day, the sun and the moon, each one traveling in its own orbit. The same thing is repeated in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 40. Kullun fi falakin yasbuhun, each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. The Quran does not say that the sun revolves around the earth. The Quran says the sun and the moon, each one traveling in its own orbit. The Arabic word used is yasbuhun, coming from the root word sabaha, describing the motion of a moving body. If you say a man is doing sabaha on the floor, it means he is not standing, it means he is walking or running. If you say a man is doing sabaha in water, it does not mean he's floating, it means he's swimming. Same way, if you use the word sabaha for a heavenly body, it means rotating about its own axis. So the Quran mentions the sun and the moon rotate, they travel in a motion that they revolve and they rotate about its own axis. Now again, this verse had put me a little bit doubts, because I had passed my ICSE in 1982 from St. Peter's School. And there in geography I learned that the sun did not rotate. The sun revolved, fine, but it was stationary. It did not rotate about its axis. And the Quran mentioned that the sun rotates about its axis. So I was a bit worried. And then I had to do a little bit of research. And then I came to know that according to the recent advances in science and astronomy, we come to know that even the sun rotates about its axis. And to prove it, you can take equipment in the laboratory, and since you can't look at the sun directly, the image of the sun can be put on a tabletop. And the sun has got certain holes, like black spots. And those black spots take about 25 days to rotate completely. So in short, the sun takes about 25 days to rotate. So the Quran is not backward, it is more up to date. I want to ask Taslima Nasreen that who could have written this 1400 years ago, that the sun and the moon, that the sun and the moon, each one travel in its own orbit, means revolving and rotating. Ask her. The Quran does not mention at all that the sun rotates or revolves around the earth. That's a misinterpretation. Since the chairman has given me permission regarding the second part of the question, and she has alleged that it is because of Islam that there is such a high rate of infanticide, female infanticide in Bangladesh. She alleged that. I want her to tell me, quote me one verse of the Quran which says that you should kill female children. In fact, according to the BBC report, in the program assignment, the title of that small clipping was Let Her Die. A British reporter, Emily Beckenin, she came from UK and she did a survey on female infanticides, and India happens to have the maximum number. And according to her, every day, more than 3,000 fetuses are being aborted on being identified that they are females. 3,000 fetuses in our mother country. And if you multiply this by 365, more than 1 million fetuses on being recognized that they are female are being aborted. Why don't you read it in the headlines in our papers? Let the papers give it on the front page every day until this female infanticide is stopped. And according to the Tamil Nadu government report, out of the live births of female children, out of 10, 4 are put to death. 4 are put to death. It had to be a Britisher to come and tell us Indians what's the rate of female infanticide in our country. Now coming to the point, what does Quran speak about female infanticide? She cannot quote any verse. I challenge her to quote any verse from the Quran which says female children should be put to death. In fact, if you read Surah Takwir, see I'm going with quotation. Taslima Nasreen only says Quran says that, Quran says this. How can a layman who has not read the Quran, or even if he has read the Quran, where will he find which verse says this, what she's saying? So you have to take it for granted. Give benefit of doubt that the Quran does say that the sun revolves around the earth, or you have to agree that it believes in female infanticide. If you read the Quran in Surah Takwir, chapter number 81, verse number 8 and 9, it says that when the female child, when she's buried alive, and when she cries out, for what crime has she been killed? On the day of judgment, she'll cry out, for what crime she has been killed? So female infanticide has been completely forbidden in Islam. In fact, all sorts of female infanticides and killing of children has been prohibited. It's mentioned in Quran, in Surah Al-Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 31, as well as in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 151, which says, kill not your children for want of sustenance. It is Allah who will provide you and your children for sustenance. In fact, Quran rebukes the thought of a person rejoicing on the birth of a male child and his faith being sad on the birth of a female child. It's mentioned in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 58 and 59. Hope that answers the question, brother.
Father Pereira wants to say something on this particular issue.
I just want to make a general comment, which I think is important at this stage. You often hear people say, oh, the Quran says this, which is an obscurantist thing. Oh, Hinduism says that, which is against progress. Oh, you can prove these things from the Bible and so on. Be very careful, firstly, when you hear things. A, often these are vague statements made, as Dr. Naik has pointed very clearly, which have no reference at all. That's the first thing. Secondly, often religious scriptures are used by politicians and are used by obscurantists to support their own prejudices. Classic instance of racism and the Bible. You know that a lot of Western Christianity through the centuries has been racist, and they have used the Bible to defend it. It's absolutely false, but here it is politics which comes to use religion for its own purposes. Remember what I said at the beginning. Every religion has a liberative element which can emancipate you, but can also oppress you, depending on how these things have been twisted. So I make this general comment because often you hear statements like this, and then they will blame, okay, Muslims, see, Muslims, what else? Or Christians, of course, Christians, or Hindus like this, or Sikhs, whatever. Be very careful, because this is the typical kind of prejudice, actually, which only, as it were, creates turbulence and does not help to clear any doubts.
More questions?
Ista Settlewat from Communalism Combat, Dr. Zaki Nayak, wanted to ask him whether he considers the attack on Dr. Bedar for saying that Hindus are not kafirs but murtads by... He was threatened with his life. Was that a fundamentalist attack on his life and freedom of expression or not?
Sister has posed the question that the person, Mr. Bedar, who said that Hindus are not kafirs and they are murtads. Therefore, is it right that the fundamentalist that threatened his life... Is that a curb of freedom of expression or not? And life. Again, two, three questions. Regarding the first part, that whatever that Mr. Bedar said, that Hindus are not kafirs, but they are murtads, does not have any base, because he may not be well-versed in the Arabic language. What is the meaning of kafir? I told you that kafir means a person who conceals the truth or rejects the truth. It does not mean that a kafir has to be a Hindu. He can be a Hindu, he may not be a Hindu. I will come to the complete answer. So only if I justify the meaning can I justify my answer, sister. If I don't justify the meaning, my answer will have no relevance. Because Quran always says, "Qul hatu burhanakum," produce your proof. While giving your answer, give your proof. Without proof, I don't give comments. So firstly, kafir does not mean a Hindu. It may be a Hindu, may not be a Hindu. And what is the meaning of murtad? Murtad is a Muslim who, after he has accepted the faith, he converts to another faith. That's called a murtad. So Mr. Bedar's explanation has got no relevance at all. Neither is it correct literally. It does not have neither a head nor a tail. Regarding whether those Muslim people, first, were they fundamentalists or not, I don't know. Were they right in putting a death sentence? I would say without proof, no one has the right to put a death sentence. If they gave an opportunity to clarify himself, and if he falters, or if he had abused the Quran, then it's a different question. Depending upon what proof did Dr. Bedar give to the Muslim students. Otherwise, I would say that without any proof, if those Muslims have called for his death, it is completely wrong. It's against Islam. Hope that answers the question, sister.
And if they have proof, then it is right. Then it's against Islam.
Fine, you can ask me a question. I thought my answer is over. The second question, I give a second answer. If it's based on truth, does a person have a right to pass a death sentence? It is like you asking me if the Indian government has proof that a person who has told the secrets of the country, of the army, of the navy, of the air force, has told to somebody else. And if he's caught and he's proved that he actually betrayed the country, the Indian government will punish with proof. Same way, if there is proof that he has betrayed or spoken something wrong, if there's proof, then I feel he requires punishment. Hope that answers the question. That's second part of the question. Is a death sentence, or if you say first part, no problem. Can you give death sentence? See, every crime, the punishments given are various. Like, for example, if you read in the trains, if you pull the chain without any reason, 500 rupees fine and 3 months imprisonment. So if you're caught, one judge may give you 500 fine, the other judge may give you 500 fine and 1 month. Some judge may give you only 3 months, some judge may give you both. The punishment differs from each judge to each judge. Regarding what does religious fundamentalism talk about if someone blasphemes, we haven't used that word, but I'm using it. Someone blasphemes, what does the Quran say? I'll quote the Quran. The Quran in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 33 states that the punishment for anyone who wages war against Allah, against God Almighty and His Messenger, or strives with might and main to create mischief in the land, his punishment is either execution or crucifixion or chopping off of limbs of the opposite side or exile. This is the law given in one verse of the Quran. Other verses say that if possible, you speak with Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal mawizatil hasna wajadilum billati ya ahlan. It is said in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 125. Invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them, and debate with them, and reason with them in ways that are best and most gracious. If you ask me, what would I do to Taslima Nasreen, since Quran gives so many options, I would say, I would call her for a public debate. That depends upon the judge. The punishment may differ on every judge. Every punishment, if enough proof is given, if you read, since you asked, the topic is religious fundamentalism, if you refer to the Bible says, and Father can correct me if I'm wrong, in the third book of the Old Testament, in Leviticus, chapter number 24, verse number 16, it states that any person who blasphemeth the name of thy Lord, he should certainly be put to death. Certainly be put to death. And the congregation. Father, if you want the Bible is available here. If you think I'm misquoting, I'm quoting verbatim, Father, from whichever version you want, whether King James version or the New Way version. I'd like to complete the quotation. If you're a fundamentalist Christian, you have to follow the Bible. The Bible says in Leviticus, chapter number 24, verse number 16, that anyone who blasphemeth the name of the Lord, he shall certainly be put to death. And all the congregation shall surely stone him, even the stranger. For anyone who's born in the land and blasphemeth the name of the Lord, he shall be put to death. So if you're a good Christian, what does the Bible say? Anyone who blasphemeth the Lord, you should be put to death. There may be other options also given in the Bible, but this is one of them.
It's an important point, so let me give you a slightly different point of view. There's such a thing in the world as mob justice or rough justice or lynching. You're familiar with these terms. In the United States, for example, for many years, even till very recently, if you were a black, a group of white men could just say, he tried to rape my daughter, and they would lynch you on the spot. So in the same way, please realize that there's such a thing as rough justice, and a lot of this is taking place and sometimes in Islamic countries. I have here a report on which comes in from Pakistan, and the title is Blasphemy Laws Are So Vague That Anyone Can Be Murdered. I can give this to anyone if you want to make Xerox copies of it. It's unfortunate. Probably the only country in the Muslim world right now that has enough of ulema to handle these cases against the Sharia is Iran. That's why you never hear cases of this in Iran. But many other instances where you appeal to the Sharia or you appeal against to an interpretation of the Quran, and you find invariably that Maulana are much too politicized, and a lot of this thing comes from politics. So therefore, to say that Islam is responsible again is wrong. You've got to see the political context of a country like Bangladesh, for example, like Pakistan, for example. like Algeria, for example, the Islamic Salvation Front, and other places like this. So this is very important to keep in mind. The instances of Dr. Bayar, etc., is what you'd call mob justice. I don't like you, you've blocked him, come out, I'll kill you. And this is what they do, you're killed. Who has the right to execute? Only the state, after a due process of trial. The trouble is, in many countries, the democratic process is so weak, and we find this so in Bangladesh today. There's a fighting going on between the Prime Minister and the other opposition leader, between Zia and Hasina. And this is one reason why these things are taking place. Now they're coming out and say, no, no, don't ever threaten the woman, otherwise be careful. Note that the Maulana who has put that that reward of 50,000 takas has not yet been arrested. There are three persons who have put rewards upon the head of Taslim, but there's only the public notification has gone out that action can be taken, but no one has taken action yet. You see, many of these things do happen. And recently you had a case, probably you picked up in the papers, an Ayatollah, Khomeini, I think, said that one Ayatollah can issue a fatwa which negates a previous fatwa. Why is it taking such a long time to say this? Huh? Why is it taking such a long time? Politics, you know from your own study of the whole Salman Rushdie case that the reason why Ayatollah Khomeini issued that fatwa was entirely political. You know it. So don't make Islam a scapegoat for the tricks of politicians. Don't make that. Christians have done this, plenty of examples of that. Hindus have done this, plenty of examples of that. Muslims are doing this, plenty of examples. Sikhs have done it, all right. You always have this kind of continual tension between religion and politics, and one will use the other. I'll give you plenty of examples from Christianity if you are patient to wait the evening. Plenty of examples, you see? So it's important to keep these two things in mind. Rough justice, one thing, and there's no way in which you can excuse this kind of thing. But unfortunately, governments are too weak to enforce it, and that's why you have what you have.
Mr. Wagle,
Dr. Nayak ne debating skills to bahut sare dikhaye. Main unse ha ya na mein jawab chahta hu. Taslima ke khilaf jin logo ne fatwa issue kiya, us amanvi fatwe ka aap samarthan karte hai ya nishedh karte hai?
Only one word. Brother had asked me the question that do I agree with the death sentence given by certain people, whatever it is, maybe two, three or four, do I agree with the death sentence given on the head of Taslima Nasreen? In one word, believe me, brother, I'm a Muslim fundamentalist. Fundamentals of Islam do not allow me to give the answer in one word. Do not allow me. That's right. I'm telling you, I will not answer because I will have to call her in the court of law, and after I've examined her, after I've integrated her, and after she's given an equal opportunity to support herself, after she has been given an equal opportunity to support herself, can the death sentence be passed? Otherwise, no, I have not met her. I have not met her. If you have contacts, you can get in front of me. I can't. Islam does not give me the permission, brother. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I'm not exactly a full-time journalist. But Dr. Naik, do you think the people who have given this punishment, announced, pronounced, whatever, have given her that opportunity?
Brother has asked the question that have those people who have passed the death sentence, have they given her opportunity to clarify herself? I don't know. I don't know. Believe me, I don't know. Maybe, may not be. I don't know. I read in the papers, the news keep on altering. No, see, I'm speaking the truth. How do I know? I don't know personally. I read in the papers. In one paper it mentions she's 29 years old. One paper she's 31. One paper says 39. One paper says she's a plain MBBS doctor. The other paper says she's a gynecologist. The other paper says anesthetist. You ask me what is she, I say I don't know.
कि बहुत सारे डॉक्टर नायक से हुए इनसे पूछना चाहता हूं कि इन्होंने हिंदू धर्म के बारे में बहुत सारी बातें कही सनातन हिंदू धर्म के बारे में और हिंदू धर्म में रिफॉर्म्स हुए क्योंकि हिंदू धर्म बड़ा हिंदू धर्म का सनातन हिंदू धर्म का मन बड़े उदार बड़ा उदार था इसे उन्होंने कहा मुझे उनसे इतना ही पूछना है कि जो चारवाक से लेकर फुले आगरकर तक सारे रिफॉर्मिस्ट हुए उन्हें जो तकलीफें झेलनी पड़ी वो हिंदू धर्म के उदार मन की निशानी है या नहीं
चारवाक से कहां तक
अभी आज तक भी लीजिए आप
इसका सीधा उत्तर यह है मैंने पहले अपने वक्तव्य में कह दिया था कि वैचारिक विरोध के आधार पर शारीरिक कष्ट किसी को दिया जाए इसका पहला उदाहरण गांधी हत्या का है चारवाक को हम लोग बृहस्पति का अवतार मानते हैं।
सावित्रीबाई फुले पर भी पत्थर फेंके गए थे। गांधी हत्या पहला उदाहरण नहीं है, शंभुक का भी पहले उदाहरण है। आगर घर की तो शव यात्रा निकाली गई थी।
देखिए ये सारे उदाहरण अंग्रेजी शिक्षा के आने के बाद के हैं, इसलिए इन सब की जिम्मेदारी मैं अंग्रेजी शिक्षा को मानता हूं। एक शंभुक का उदाहरण आप छोड़ दीजिए, एक शंभुक का उदाहरण आप छोड़ दीजिए। मैंने कहा वैचारिक विरोध के आधार पर, वैचारिक विरोध का जहां तक चारवाक का आपने नाम लिया, आप इतिहास में कहीं नहीं बता
सकते। टॉर्चर तो हर रिफॉर्मिस्ट को किया गया है।
आप मुझे बताइए चारवाक पर कौन से अत्याचार है और आप किस इतिहास के आधार पर?
शंभुक के बारे में थोड़ा सा एक्सप्लेनेशन दीजिए।
पहले आप चारवाक को वापस ले लीजिए, फिर मैं शंभुक का उत्तर।
हर रिफॉर्मिस्ट को फिजिकल टॉर्चर किया गया है आज तक। जो जहां तक मैं अयोध्या तक बोलता हूं कि अयोध्या के बारे में बात करने वाले जो लोग हैं और हिंदू धर्म में जो खराब नीतियां है या खराब अंधश्रद्धा है उनके खिलाफ बोलने वाले आज के जो आज तक के नए नौजवान हैं अंधश्रद्धा निर्मूलन समिति के, उनको भी फिजिकल टॉर्चर का सामना करना पड़ा है। यही मैं आपको कहता हूँ, क्योंकि ये आपकी बात सच नहीं है कि रिफॉर्मिस्ट को कोई तकलीफ नहीं दी गई और सिर्फ डिबेट चलाया गया या डायलॉग चलाया गया। फिजिकल टॉर्चर तो हुआ ही है और इसके तो इतने सारे उदाहरण हैं, आप इतिहास पढ़ के वो ढूंढ निकाल सकते हैं।
आपने चारवाक से प्रारंभ किया, मेरी आपसे प्रार्थना, या आप बोले या मैं बोलूं, मेरी आपसे प्रार्थना है कि चारवाक को किस प्रकार का कष्ट दिया गया ये आप किसी इतिहास के आधार पर हमें बता दीजिए, तो मैं आपके प्रश्न का उत्तर देने का या अपने विचार को सुधारने का दोनों प्रयत्न करने के लिए मैं तैयार। आई एम ऑलवेज ओपन फॉर रेक्टिफिकेशन एंड करेक्शन। कोई मुझे बता दे कि चारवाक के इतिहास में कहां ये मिला हुआ है, या कम से कम आप स्वीकार करेंगे चारवाक को नहीं दिया गया कोई भी शारीरिक दंड बाद में हुआ। मैं इस आक्षेप से सहमत नहीं हूँ कि चारवाक का इतिहास मिटा दिया गया है, क्योंकि चारवाक को आप कृपा करके शांति से विचार कीजिए। चारवाक को हम लोग बृहस्पति का अवतार मानते हैं और चारवाक के नास्तिकवादों के जो सिद्धांत हैं वो बराबर तब से आज तक चले आ रहे हैं, और जहाँ तक मेरी भारतीय इतिहास की जानकारी है वहाँ तक चारवाक को या उनके अनुयायियों को, जैसा कि मैंने कहा अंग्रेजी शिक्षा प्रणाली आने के पहले तक, वैचारिक विरोध के आधार पर कोई उनको तकलीफ दी गई हो ऐसा मेरी जानकारी में अब तक नहीं है। अगर आप प्रमाणों के साथ कोई बात दें तो मैं या तो उसका उत्तर दे सकूंगा या मैं अपने विचार सुधार सकूंगा, मुझे इसमें कोई आपत्ति नहीं है।
अच्छा,
शंभुक पर अगर आप चाहें।
द स्पीकर आई थिंक हैज मेड हिज स्टैंड क्वाइट क्लियर, आई थिंक वी शुड गो फॉर अदर क्वेश्चंस।
माय नेम इज जावेद आनंद, आई एम फ्रॉम कम्युनलिज्म कॉम्बैट। डॉक्टर नायक हैज सेड रिपीटेडली that the punishment for any crime depends on the gravity of the crime, and he has specifically talked about the American state and once about the Indian state, and saying for treason, if any official of the government of India, employed by the government of India, or any official employed by the government of the United States reveals the secrets of the state which compromise the integrity and sovereignty of that state, then he should be punished to death. And is there anything wrong in that? Or there has to be some punishment that follows. That is my impression. I stand corrected.
Yes.
Having said this, he then proceeds to make the point that Taslima Nasreen, for example, he says that there are so many contradictory reports in various papers that he can come to no conclusion whatsoever. Maybe he is also in doubt as to whether any Maulana has or has not passed a fatwa against Taslima Nasreen. But it seems to me that contained in that argument also is that if Taslima Nasreen has said anything against the Quran, because that is her firm belief, just as it is a firm belief of many other people that Quran is the word of Allah, then she can be tried by numerous authorities, including by Dr. Zakir Naik himself. If Taslima Nasreen were here today, he will know her age, he will know whether she's a gynecologist, whether she believes in Islam, etc., etc. At the end of which, he can pronounce some punishment for her, which could also mean chopping off opposite limbs or head or exile. Those four options is given. Now, if there are to be many centers of jurisdiction, I mean many, many people, whether it's a mullah or a pandit or a Shankaracharya or a pope or whatever it is, who can simultaneously decide what crime for what punishment, then I have a question. I come from the district of Allahabad, from a village in Allahabad. where there's a mosque in which I prayed for many, many years during my years. I know for a fact, most of us Muslims know for a fact, as also the Hindus of the village, that in that mosque on the outer boundary, there are statues which could only have come from some temple or another. If some pandit from my village in Allahabad decides that a temple was destroyed here a few hundred years back or whatever it is, and for that crime, that pandit sitting in that village decides that the Muslims of that village be killed and all the Hindus killed, all the Muslims or as many Muslims as they can, is there something wrong with it? Is this what he's suggesting?
If he asks, please repeat the question, it is going to be very difficult.
Well, I'll summarize it. Can there be many, many centers? Can there be many, many centers of decision making in terms of what constitutes crime and what is punishment?
Brother, thank you for the short speech. In your short speech, you have asked at least 10, 15 questions, if not more. Whatever I can remember, one question. That's all the previous thing is nullified. If I don't answer, don't blame me. Because they misquoted me saying that the Indian government can punish her to death. I didn't say that. Punishment. What punishment? Depends upon the law of the government. Coming to your second part. You said that even Dr. Zakir Naik can call her here, can ask her age, can ask her profession, and you said it in very beautiful. Fine, no problem. Please let me complete my answer. I gave you enough time to pose your question. Enough time, please give me opportunity to answer. And even Dr. Naik can sentence her to death or cut off her limbs, etc. No, Dr. Zakir Naik cannot. Dr. Zakir Naik cannot. I don't have the authority. I can give a fatwa. Please let me tell you what the meaning of fatwa. Again, you may not be aware of the word. Arabic word fatwa means opinion. But my opinion has got no value. Since we believe in freedom of speech, every individual has a right to his opinion, including me, including you, brother. You can, like Kushwant Singh offers her his home, he has a right to his opinion. I can't object. But I can't sentence her. Only a qazi has a right to give judgment and the verdict. There's a world of a difference between fatwa and a verdict. Fatwa, I'd like to give the example, like suppose a lawyer, he gives his opinion to the judge, but the judge can differ from the lawyer. The fatwa need not be a judgment. Let me remind you that, brother. I may be an expert, which I am not, I as a doctor cannot give a fatwa on Islam. Fatwa, in my personal opinion, yes, as an individual, but not as a scholar, neither as a judge, because I'm not a judge. Regarding your one summarized question, that can, and if I've forgotten the question, you can repeat, brother, that can the same crime have different punishments, or can different centers be set up for punishment? Correct, brother? Can you repeat the question, brother? For example, in India there are courts of law which are set up to decide whether a crime has been committed, if committed according to the law of the land, what punishment should follow. In your view, whether in India or in Bangladesh or anywhere else, what is the state which can accuse certain authorities to judicial? Can there be other centers of, brother is asking me that can there be several centers of giving judgment in India first, then I come to Bangladesh. I'm sorry, again, he has misunderstood the Islamic law. In India, the Muslim Personal Law Board can only give judgment on personal issues like divorce, like marriage, like inheritance. They cannot pass their law on criminal cases because we have a common criminal law in India. So the question is baseless. Regarding Bangladesh, I don't know. Again, don't think I'm trying to avoid the question. Again, I don't know how many boards or how many courts of law are there in Bangladesh. But if you talk of Islam in the previous ages, there was something like Khilafat, there was a Khalifa, and he was the head. There may be small courts, like how we have a problem in the low court, you go to a high court. If you have a problem in the high court, you go to Supreme Court. So there, the Khilafat, the main court was him. He was a Khalifa, he appoints the main chief judge, like how we have Supreme Court. If there are any small court falters, you can go to the chief one. But today, the Khilafat has been abolished. But maybe countries may be having their own way of law court, high court, supreme court. You have to analyze the history of the country. Hope that answers the question, brother. Maybe a new question, but I hope
I have your permission to just ask one question, that you cannot be confused about one issue
that some Maulana, however highly respected he may be, has not been made a judge or a small court or a high court or a supreme court in the country of Bangladesh, does he have a right to give a public call for the head of the Sima industry?
That's right. If you had heard my answer correctly, with attention, you would have got the answer. I said everyone, including you and I, have the right to give fatwa. Fatwa means opinion.
Please let me complete. He gave a fatwa. His opinion was that he called for the head of Taslim al-Nasri.
So you defend that? 1,000 Bangla takas, anybody who kills Taslim al-Nasri will get died. It's a call in front of the
defense. That's right. Now 50,000 takas have just come now. First, your question did not include that. I answer to that. Please let me answer, brother, then I'll give you an opportunity. With the permission of the chair. Does anyone have a right to call for anyone's head, even if it be a fatwa or opinion? Even while giving opinion, you cannot slander anyone, neither can you abuse anyone. If it's an Islamic country, a person, Taslim al-Nasreen, can sue that Maulana, saying that he... Please let me complete, sister. See, I'm not interrupting your questions, so if you please not interrupt my answer, it will be better. I'm just giving a general opinion of Islam. Please, sister, if you allow me. She has a right if it's an Islamic country. I don't know how far is Bangladesh an Islamic country, how far are they following the laws of Islam, I don't know. Maybe they are following, maybe not following. So she has a right, if she thinks that the death sentence put on her head is wrong, she has a right to take him to an Islamic court, if there is one, and sue. But let me link your answer with the comment laid down by the learned speaker, Father Pereira. He made a comment that it is very easy to frame anyone in the blasphemous law and sentence that person to death. Or taking the example of Taslim al-Nasreen, that it is not very easy, as easy, Father Pereira has said, because if you produce a witness in the court of law, if the crime is a small crime, two witnesses are required. If the crime is great, four witnesses. And if any of those four witnesses falter, believe me, if any of those four witnesses falter during cross-examination, all four of them receive 80 lashes each. 80 lashes. It's not that easy. It's not as easy as we take an oath in the court of Indian government. Main sach kahunga, sach ke siwa kuch nahi kahunga, and then you can lie. It's not that easy. You receive 80 lashes each. And believe me, it's very difficult to bear those lashes. It's not as easy as Father Pereira has made it sound. Hope that answers the question, brother.
Yes. No, I think we should...
Dr. Nayak, Sajid Rashid, Urdu Times. हम लोग एक ऐसे मुल्क में रहते हैं जहां पर बहुत सारे फिरके के, बहुत सारे सांप्रदाय के लोग रहते हैं, और उसका अपना एक कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन है जिसने लोगों को सजा देने का अपना एक मयार मुकर्रर किया है. ऐसे देश में रहते हुए क्या आप किसी को किसी भी किस्म की तजही के कुरान की मजम्मत के लिए या उसकी गलत कहने के लिए क्या आप वो इस्लामी सजाएं तजवीज करेंगे जो इस्लाम में कही गई है, और क्या वो यहाँ पर इस मुल्क में जिसका अपना एक कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन है क्या वो सही हो सकती हैं?
Brother has again asked a similar sort of question, that since we have different religions, can every religion follow their own law? Or suppose if anyone has abused the Quran, can you follow the Islamic law? Again, brother, let me clarify. Wherever the criminal law is in any country you take, whether Saudi Arabia, whether Iran, whether Pakistan, whether America, whether England, whether India, the criminal law has to be common. The civil law can change. The civil law can change. The criminal law in Saudi Arabia is same whether Muslim or non-Muslim. In India, the criminal law is same whether Muslim or non-Muslim. So you cannot have a different criminal law. You can give your comments, but you can give your opinion whether that person should be given punishment of 1 year or 2 years or death sentence, whatever it is, but you can't practice it because you have to practice a common criminal law. If Islamic State, then you have to abide by the Quran. You cannot deviate from the Quran. But since India is not an Islamic country, we cannot implement the Quranic law where it comes to criminal punishment. Hope that answers the question, brother.
I am Maria Sresh, a religious sister. And I want to ask Mr. Sahini, Ashok Sahini Shahani, why did you translate the book Raja into Marathi?
At last, a simple question.
Well, I translated it. One thing is because I like the book. Another thing was it was some kind of an atonement, because Taslima had the courage to write the kind of book she wrote. The minorities being put to trouble, a lot of suffering, torture in her own country, which is a Muslim majority country. Whereas almost the same, or maybe to a lesser degree, there may be some difference. The same things happened in the December and January riots in Bombay. But I found that no literary person here, I'm a Maharashtrian, no Marathi author has had the courage to say that it has put us all to shame. Taslima had that courage and she did it.
Question to Dr. Zakir Naik. The fundamentalists of Bangladesh are themselves responsible for bringing Taslima Nasrim into the limelight by announcing hefty prices on her head. If they had instead ignored her and allowed her to have her say, this issue would not have risen at all, and perhaps it would not have come here to discuss this subject.
Brothers asked a very good question, that if the so-called, in inverted commas, Muslim fundamentalists, so-called I say, if they would not have announced the price on her head, we would not have gathered here today. I agree with you. But you put the blame on the Muslim fundamentalist, I put the blame on the media. Difference of opinion. Even if an obscure organization like BSSP, Bangladesh Sahaba Sainik Parishad, who knew of it? No one. Even if the leader of that organization, Maulana Habibur Rahman, and I do know, brother, that somebody has called for that sentence. If an obscure person, an insignificant organization, calls for that sentence, why does the Indian media has to highlight it? Front page. Imagine front page news. According to the High Commission, this is I'm quoting from Delhi newspaper, according to the High Commission of Bangladesh, he said that the amount of news that the Indian media has given to Taslima Nasreen is not even 1% of the news that's there in the Bangladesh newspapers. So you blame, you ask me, are the Muslim fundamentalists to blame? You may blame them. I would say even if they are to blame, or whether they are not, irrespective of that, I believe the journalists of India and the papers of India, they are much more wiser. So they should not have highlighted it, and neither would be here to discuss the matter. Yes, brother.
The Indian media has highlighted this issue in order to save her life, because she's the only person, she's a woman, and she's helpless in front of all these religious fanatics. So the Indian media is only trying to save her life.
That's right. Please let me answer, brother, then you can continue the question. Brother, I said the Indian media tried her to save from an obscure organization, insignificant Maulana Habibur Rahman. So today, if you hear someone in the train saying, I'm going to kill the Prime Minister, you're going to give the headlines in your papers. No, Justin, it's a rhetoric question, brother. I don't want you to answer. Brother, please. Brother, you have a right to ask a question later on. Let me complete my answer. So you said the Indian media. See, that's my opinion. My opinion can be wrong, brother. It's my opinion. I'm not saying my opinion has to be right. Some people in the audience may agree with my opinion, some people may not. So I feel that any insignificant person, suppose if maybe the call was given by the leading organization, then you have to think over it. I'm not commenting on the ban. I'm not commenting on the death call, whether it's right or wrong. I'm saying, why did we have to give it headlines? Because for sensationalism. That's what I say. That's my opinion, brother. If you like it, you can take it. If you don't like it, you can refuse it. That's my opinion, brother.
I had a correction. The call for the sentence to Taslima Nasreen is not that insignificant as he is trying to make out. The call has been given officially by the political party Jamaat-e-Islami in Bangladesh.
I am Professor Hamza Virani. I would like to ask Brother Ashok Sahani, that you said that this journalist, they have put life of Taslima Nasreen in problem. and he says that Indian media is trying to save the life of Taslima Nasreen. So first you say, as a journalist, I don't know whether you are a journalist or not. No, good. So some journalists, they have put the life of Taslima Nasreen in danger, and he says that journalists are trying to save the life of Taslima Nasreen. I want to know what is right, whether they have put her in problem or they are trying to take out her from the problem.
The problem is not that simple, of course. The problem is a bit complicated in the way, meaning the fundamentalists in Bangladesh had been itching for Taslima's head for a long time. Even earlier to the interview that she gave to Statesman. And if you ask me my personal opinion, they might have been misled by a wrong idea of nationalism. Because Taslima, on her way back to Dhaka from Paris, stayed in Calcutta, and on the top of it said that Calcutta is my second home. You tell that to anybody from Shiv Sena in Bombay, for instance. If Imran comes to Bombay and says that Bombay is my second home, I mean, the people in Pakistan are going to be bothered about it. Or even if a person like Gavaskar goes to the cancer hospital function, then there's a lot of UN cry in the newspapers about why should Gavaskar go. And, you know, I mean, this is all mixed up. That's what I say. I mean, it's a bit complicated. But all the same, I mean, since the Statesman has not come out with an open apology, or open, unbarred, undeterred apology, that they had been the cause, they had been made the cause for this demand, I mean, things would have been different.
मेरा नाम रवि है, महानगर से आया हूँ. मुझे डॉक्टर व्यास से एक सवाल पूछना है. आपने कहा कि हिंदू धर्म में संवाद का बहुत महत्व है, मतलब जो लोग खुद को हिंदू समझते हैं उन्होंने संवाद करना जरूरी है अपोजिट विचारों के लोगों से. बाला साहब ठाकरे ने नामांतर के सवाल के ऊपर किसी भी दलित से सवाल नहीं किया. लाल कृष्ण आडवाणी जी ने बाबरी मस्जिद के मसले पर किसी भी मुस्लिम लोगों से संवाद करने की कोशिश नहीं की. कोर्ट की तरफ से हो रही थी, वो भी उन लोगों ने नाकारी है. क्या आप लोग, आपकी दृष्टि में बाला साहेब ठाकरे, लाल कृष्ण आडवाणी, ये लोग हिंदू है?
सबसे पहले मेरी प्रार्थना यह है कि इट्स बेटर दैट वी डिस्कस प्रिंसिपल्स एंड थियोरीज देन वी डिस्कस पर्संस एंड इवेंट्स. क्योंकि फिर प्रश्न ही आ जाएगा. मैं हिंदू धर्मशास्त्रों की जिम्मेदारी लेने के लिए तैयार हूँ, संसार भर के सारे हिंदुओं के कार्यों की जिम्मेदारी मैं नहीं ले सकता. हिंदू धर्मशास्त्रों में कहीं अगर ये बताया गया हो, एक मिनट, हिंदू धर्मशास्त्रों में कहीं अगर ये बताया गया हो कि जो आपके विरुद्ध विचार वाले हों या जो आपके विचारों को स्वीकार न करें उन सबको आप मार डालिए या उनके अंगच्छेद कर दीजिए, उनको देश निकाला दे दीजिए, ऐसा धर्मशास्त्रों में कहीं उल्लेख हो तो आप हमें बताइए, उस पर मैं विचार करने के लिए तैयार हूँ. किन्होंने क्या किया व्यक्तिगत रूप से, कौन क्या कर, और खासकर आपने जो प्रश्न पूछे हैं बिल्कुल राजनीतिक पार्टियों के बारे में. आज की भारत की राजनीति इस प्रकार की है कि मैं उससे दूर रहना ही पसंद करूंगा. हालांकि किसी भारतीय नागरिक के लिए या संसार में किसी नागरिक के लिए राजनीति से एकदम दूर रहना बड़ा कठिन है. फिर भी एक बात भी मैं कहना चाहूंगा कि आप स्वयं अपने आप से ही पूछ लीजिए, या ये इस प्रश्न का सबसे ज़्यादा सही उत्तर लाल कृष्ण आडवाणी या बाल ठाकरे साहब भी दे सकते हैं कि सनातन वैदिक धर्म के हिंदू धर्म शास्त्रों के अनुसार वे अपने को हिंदू मानते हैं या नहीं. मैं कौन होता हूँ निर्णय देने वाला. हाँ, इतनी देर में चुप रहा, एक बात मैं जरूर कहना चाहूँगा. हो सकता है अब तक हम भ्रम में रहा. नायक साहब ने जो कहा कि फतवा का अर्थ केवल ओपिनियन होता है, ये आज मैंने जाना. अब तक हम लोग ये समझते थे कि फतवा माने किसी धर्माचार्य के द्वारा या किसी उच्च अधिकारी के द्वारा कोई जो आदेश दिया जाए उसको फतवा कहते हैं, ऐसा मैं अब तक समझता था. हो सकता है मैं भूल में रहा हूँ. तो ये मेरी भूल हो सकती है, इसलिए मैं ये निवेदन करूंगा कि किसी जाति विशेष के बारे में मेरे पर्सनल ओपिनियन का कोई उपयोग नहीं है। यहाँ हम विचार ये कर रहे हैं कि हिंदू धर्म शास्त्रों के अनुसार विरुद्ध विचार वालों के साथ क्या व्यवहार होना चाहिए। वहां जब संवाद की बात आती है तो मैंने आपको पहले ही बताया कि हमारे यहाँ पहले हमेशा पूर्व पक्ष और फिर उत्तर पक्ष रखा जाता है। आप ये जानते हैं कि दयानंद सरस्वती के समय तक शास्त्रार्थों की धूम मची रहती थी। दयानंद सरस्वती शायद प्रारंभिक सुधारकों में से, जिनको सुधारक लोग कहते हैं, धर्म में परिवर्तन करने वाले जो माने जाते हैं, उनमें दयानंद सरस्वती प्रारंभिक लोगों में से थे। आप अच्छी तरह से जानते हैं कि दयानंद सरस्वती के जीवन में और उनके पश्चात भी लगभग 50 वर्षों तक सनातनियों में और आर्य समाजियों में स्थान स्थान पर, शहर शहर में, गाँव गाँव में शास्त्रार्थ होते रहे, पुस्तकें छपती रहीं, सैकड़ों और हजारों पुस्तकें छपती रहीं। दर्शन शास्त्र में शंकराचार्य, रामानाचार्य आदि के विचारों में एक दूसरे के विरोध होते हुए आज तक हजारों पुस्तकें छपी हुई हैं। ये संवाद के ही तो उदाहरण है। आज का कोई एक नेता अगर किसी के साथ संवाद बिना किए कोई काम कर देता है तो उसकी जिम्मेदारी आप हिंदू धर्म शास्त्रों पर कैसे डाल सकते हैं?
सवाल का जवाब नहीं दिया इन्होंने। दैट कांट बी हेल्प, दैट यू कैन ऑलवेज एस्केप दैट।
आपने ऐसा बोला कि यहाँ के कर्मों का फल परलोक में नहीं होता है, तो आप जो सनातन वैदिक धर्म के जो आप प्रतिनिधित्व कर रहे हैं, तो आपके आपके हिसाब से कर्म किसको बोलेंगे? कर्म का क्या है डेफिनेशन?
बहुत अच्छा किया आपने, बड़ा अच्छा प्रश्न पूछा, क्योंकि अन्यथा भी मैं ये चाह रहा था कि खासकर साहनी साहब ने जो अपने भाषण में एक बात कही थी कि द प्रॉब्लम इज दैट एवरी रिलीजन हैज ए बुक एंड वी कांट बिलीव इन ए बुक रिटन बिफोर 1000 years और 1000 years और क्रोर्स ऑफ ईयर्स। सबसे पहली बात यह है कि मेरा निवेदन यह है कि यू आर एट फुल लिबर्टी नॉट टू एक्सेप्ट एनी रिलीजन एंड रिमेन अनरिलीजियस, बट यू हैव नो अथॉरिटी और यू हैव नो लिबर्टी टू से दैट वी डू बिलीव अ धर्म एंड डू नॉट बिलीव अ धर्म ग्रंथ। इस पर आप ध्यान दीजिएगा। हम नास्तिक रहना या परलोक को न मानना, इसकी छूट सबको है, आज के जमाने में भी है, पहले के जमाने में भी थी। लेकिन आप ये कहें कि हम धर्म को स्वीकार करते हैं लेकिन धर्म का हम परिवर्तन करते रहना चाहिए, उसके लिए आपको मेरी बात का उत्तर देना पड़ेगा कि धर्म का फल अगर परलोक में मिलता है, अगर मैं इसमें इसलिए कह रहा हूँ कि जो लोग ये मानते हैं कि धर्म का फल परलोक में मिलता है उनकी ओर से ये प्रश्न है, अगर आप ये मानते हैं कि धर्म का फल परलोक में नहीं मिलता, धर्म का फल ईश्वर नहीं देता, तो धर्म कौन सी चीज है जिसको आप मानना चाहते हैं? धर्म है क्या चीज? अब मैं आपके प्रश्न पर आता हूँ कि कर्म किसे कहते हैं। जहाँ तक हिंदू धर्म शास्त्रों का प्रश्न, हो सकता है कुछ अन्य संप्रदायों में ऐसा हो कि आप 7-6 दिन कुछ भी करें, एक दिन किसी पूजा गृह में जाकर पूजा कर लें तो आप धार्मिक बने रह सकते हैं, कहीं ऐसा हो तो मैं नहीं जानता। हिंदू धर्म शास्त्रों का जहाँ तक प्रश्न है, हमारे यहाँ प्रातः काल से लेकर रात्रि तक और रात्रि से लेकर प्रातः काल तक 24 घंटे 12 महीने और जीवन भर शरीर इंद्रिय मन से जो कुछ चेष्टा जो क्रिया हम करते हैं वो सब कर्म है और वो सब धर्मशास्त्र के क्षेत्र के अंतर्गत आता है। मैं किसी को किस दृष्टि से देख रहा हूँ ये भी एक कर्म है। अगर मैं अच्छी दृष्टि से पवित्र दृष्टि से देख रहा हूँ तो मैं पुण्य कर रहा हूँ, अगर मैं अपवित्र दृष्टि से किसी पर को देख रहा हूँ तो पाप कर रहा हूँ, उसका भी फल मुझे मिलेगा। इसलिए कर्म को आप किसी एक सीमित क्षेत्र में कभी नहीं बांध सकते। शरीर इंद्रिय मन और बुद्धि इन सब के जो भी प्रयत्न हैं वे सारे प्रयत्न कर्म हैं और ऐसा कोई प्रयत्न नहीं होता जिसका फल केवल यहाँ मिलकर रह जाए। हर कर्म का फल कुछ न कुछ यहाँ के बाद भी मिलता है। जिनको ईश्वर पर विश्वास न हो, जिनको परलोक पर विश्वास न हो, उनसे हम अलग बात कर सकते हैं। आज का मंच मैं समझता हूँ उसके लिए नहीं है। हम ये नहीं कहते जो ईश्वर को नहीं मानते उनको हम एकदम छोड़ देंगे, हम उन पर भी विचार करने के लिए तैयार हैं और तर्कों के आधार पर। शास्त्र को छोड़ दीजिए, किसी शास्त्र को आप कुरान को मत मानिए, पुराण को मत मानिए, वेद को मत मानिए, बाइबल को मत मानिए, फिर भी हम तर्कों से और युक्तियों से ईश्वर को सिद्ध कर सकते हैं, ऐसा हमारा विश्वास है। आप कोई अलग बैठक उसके लिए बुला सकते हैं, लेकिन जो ईश्वर को मानते हैं उनके लिए हमेशा यह प्रश्न है कि जो कुछ कर्म हम कर रहे हैं उसको कोई देख रहा है? हम मैं 2 मिनट के लिए लेना चाहूंगा। मैं अकेले हमारे प्रसिद्ध है कि एक गुरु ने अपने शिष्यों को पूरा अध्यापन करने के बाद फल दे दिए, जाओ एक एक फल ले जाओ, ऐसी जगह खा लो जहां कोई न देखता हो। जब वे वापस आए तो किसी ने कहा कि मैं एक बंद कमरे में मैंने कमरा बंद कर लिया खा लिया, किसी ने कहा मैंने पानी में जाकर खा लिया, किसी ने कहा जंगल में जाकर खा लिया। एक शिष्य आया जिसने कहा गुरु जी मुझे ऐसी कोई जगह मिली नहीं जहाँ कोई ना देख रहा हो, इसलिए मैं फल वापस लेकर आ गया हूँ। तो ये भावना अगर मनुष्य में है कि हम जो कुछ कर रहे हैं उसे कोई अवश्य देख रहा है, और आज अगर हम छूट गए तो भी आगे फल मिलेगा, तो ही समाज में व्यवस्था ठीक रह सकती है। मैं एक बात और कहना चाहूंगा कि धर्म थोड़ी देर के लिए मान लीजिए कि काल्पनिक हो, मान लीजिए, हम नहीं मानते काल्पनिक, हम तो अत्यंत सत्य मानते हैं, पर जैसे कार्ल मार्क्स ने कहा कि धर्म अफीम की गोली है, थोड़ी देर के लिए हम मान भी नहीं कि वो अफीम की गोली है, तो भी समाज की सुव्यवस्था के लिए वही अफीम की गोली परम आवश्यक है। आप भ्रष्टाचार निवारण नहीं, जो भ्रष्टाचार आएगा उसको आप कहाँ रोकेंगे? हाउ लॉन्ग यू कैन गो पुलिस ऑन ए पुलिस? आज सारी अव्यवस्था इसलिए हो रही है कि परलोक और ईश्वर पर से लोगों का विश्वास हट गया है, धर्म पर से लोगों का विश्वास हो गया है, हट गया है, केवल अपनी बुद्धि पर लोगों को विश्वास है। अगर मैं अपराध करके पुलिस से बच सकता हूँ, या पुलिस को घूस खिलाकर बच सकता हूँ, या अंत में न्यायालयों में भी कुछ उपद्रव करके या कुछ भी करके, मैं नाम नहीं लेना चाहता, मैं अगर बच सकता हूँ तो अपराध करने में कोई दोष नहीं है। ये बुद्धिमत्ता की बात है। ज्यादा बुद्धिमान जो होते हैं वो ज्यादा अच्छे उपाय सोच करके अपने को बचा लेने का प्रयास करते हैं और बचते हैं, इसलिए वो सोचते हैं बच गए। अपराधों के बढ़ने का मूल कारण ये है, आप जितना अधिक सेकुलरिज्म का प्रचार करते जाएंगे उतना अधिक अपराध बढ़ता चला जाएगा, इस पर आप ध्यान दीजिएगा। अंततः इन अपराधों को नष्ट करने का एकमात्र उपाय है कि प्रत्येक कर्म पर हम ये ध्यान रखें कि ईश्वर भी उसे देख रहा है।
मेरा सवाल डॉक्टर व्यास से है। आप सनातन धर्म को रिप्रेजेंट कर रहे हैं यहाँ पर, और आपने कहा कि धर्म के अंदर कोई एडिशन नहीं होना चाहिए, और मैं आप
ये मैंने नहीं,
अच्छा आपने नहीं कहा, मुझे आप ये बता सकते हैं कि किसी सनातन धर्म के किसी शास्त्र में हिंदू वर्ड लिखा हुआ है, या ये लिखा हुआ है कि ये हिंदू धर्म भी कोई आने वाला है? अगर ये नहीं है तो ये सनातन धर्म में ये हिंदू वर्ड कहाँ से आया, और ये हिंदू वर्ड सनातन धर्म से किस तरह से रिलेटेड है, और वो कहाँ से आया हुआ है?
पहली बात ये है कि हिंदू शब्द आप जो समझ रहे हैं कि वो पारसियों के या फारस वालों के आने के बाद हिंदू शब्द हमारी जाति के लिए प्रचलित हुआ, वो थोड़ा आपका भ्रम है। कालिका पुराण आदि कुछ ग्रंथों में हिंदू शब्द का पहले से हिंदवो विंध्य मावेशन वहाँ स्पष्ट उल्लेख है। हिंदू शब्द की उत्पत्ति आपको संस्कृत के पुराने कोशों में मिल जाती है, हिमालय से लेकर इंदु सरोवर तक एक प्रथा रही है। शब्द किसी का पहला शब्द और अंतिम शब्द, पहला अक्षर अंतिम अक्षर मिलाकर पूरा शब्द बन जाता है। आज भी ये प्रथा अन्य भाषाओं, डॉक्टर में डी आर लिख देते हैं, डॉक्टर का पहला अक्षर डी, अंतिम अक्षर आर, डी आर का मतलब डॉक्टर, एम आर का मतलब मिस्टर। वैसे हिमालय से लेकर इंदु सरोवर पर्यंत का जो देश है वो हिंदू देश है, इसलिए हिंदुओं का जो स्थान है वो हिंदुस्तान है, ऐसा उल्लेख पुराणों में और उसके कुछ प्राचीन साहित्य में मिलता है, नंबर वन। नंबर दो, भाषा विज्ञान की दृष्टि अगर आप विचार करें तो सिंधु विदेशी जब यहाँ आए तो उनको सिंधु नदी सबसे पहले मिली, सिंधु के आधार पर सिंधुस्तान बना, और सकार का उच्चारण हकार करने की कई भाषाओं में प्रवृत्ति है, इसलिए जैसे सप्ताह का हफ्ता, सरस्वती का हरहवती, वैसे इस आधार पर भी सिंधु का हिंदू बनकर सिंधुस्तान से हिंदुस्तान बन गया है। और ये मैंने कभी नहीं कहा कि कोई एडिशन नहीं होना चाहिए, मैंने ये कहा कि जो मूल शास्त्रों के सिद्धांत हैं उन सिद्धांतों में परिवर्तन करने का हमें कोई अधिकार नहीं है, क्योंकि फल देने वाले हम नहीं हैं, इतना ही मैंने कहा है।
आई लाइक टू मेक अ कमेंट
वेरी
ब्रीफली रिगार्डिंग द क्वेश्चन सेड बाय द ब्रदर टू डॉक्टर व्यास, यू हैव गिवन द करेक्ट डेफिनेशन ऑफ the word Hindu, and he said that Hindu is a person living in India, in Hindustan. But that's a geographical definition. If you agree with that definition, even I am a Hindu. But what brother was referring to is the theological definition of Hinduism mentioned in the Hindu scriptures, which I, being a student of comparative religion, I don't come across any. This definition has also been agreed by Swami Vivekananda, that Hindu is a geographical definition, meaning those people living on this side of the Indus Valley civilization. By that, I'm a Hindu. But actually, the religion should be called a Vedantist religion, those who follow the Vedas. And one more clarification regarding, you said that I had mentioned that fatwa is opinion. Yes, I did mention it. But if that opinion is given by the judge sitting on the seat of judgment, it is taken as a judgment and a verdict. So fatwa can also mean a verdict, let me clarify. And Quran clearly states, in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 59, that if you are in doubt, ask the person who knows. So if the Quran speaks about medicine, and if you have a doubt, you will take fatwa from a doctor.
I have a right to give fatwa when Quran is talking about medicine. I have a right. I have a right to opinion. But if it's talking about fiqh and masail, I can give fatwa, but it will have no value. You'll have to go to a faqih. So in the same way, if the fatwa is given by a judge sitting on the judgment seat, it is taken for verdict. But given by a layman, it is just a layman's opinion. Sister has asked a similar question. She said, we have talked enough of Taslima Nasreen Zajja. Now we're going to talk on the satanic verses, which I can give a lecture on that, which I don't intend doing. Regarding the verdict, again, it comes to the same thing as I mentioned earlier. The verdict does not change. Same. But if you want me to throw some light on the satanic verses, I do agree that Salman Rushdie has abused our beloved Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him. He has abused his wives, etc., who are the Ummul Mu'mineen, the mothers of all the Muslims. He has. But what I fail to realize, that why hasn't some scholar thrown some light on what else has written on that book, which I will give my opinion. Why I'm giving the opinion? Because I have read that book, Satanic Verses. I have read that. If you want to read, you can go to London or America. There's a copy freely available. I had been to London and America. Just giving a gist on what Salman Rushdie, besides he abusing the Muslim characters, he has even abused his protectors. The London people, the British government who have protected them, he has abused them. On the very first page, or you could say the first page of the first chapter, actually it's page number 3, he has abused the Londoners. He says, London bhai, the first page of first chapter, that's page number 3. London bhai, and he abuses. I can't use that word, believe me, I can't use that word. I tried to use that word when I'm having a dialogue or debate with a priest while I was quoting the Bible in Deuteronomy, chapter number 23, verse number 2, which says, the dash, I don't want to say the word, the dash, shall not enter the congregation until the 10th generation. If you want to know the exact word, I'll just give a small brief joke, that when there was a party going on, everyone who wanted something on the table did some rhyming. So the Duke said, Queen so fine, pass the wine. The one person who's English pronunciation is not bad, and he wanted to have some custard. So he said, Duke the dash, pass the custard. So now you know what the word is. If you don't know, you can refer to the Bible. It is mentioned 3 times. And Salman Rushdie used that word 29 times. 29 times. Imagine. And the irony is that the British government speaks of freedom of speech. According to an article in the Daily News in London, 22nd of May, 1989, there was a big article called for ban. Ban for whom? Not for Salman Rushdie. Called for ban for Mickey. He was an actor from America. Mickey, he came and he used the four-letter word for the policies of Margaret Thatcher. I sure you don't want me to repeat that four-letter word. It is father, uncle, cousin, king. Still, if you don't know, ask the person who knows. He used that four-letter word to describe the policies of Margaret Thatcher and that. And the MPs, the Tories of that parliament, they said, call for ban. Now Salman Rushdie uses that same word, but makes it active, adding ing, ing. Four letter, he makes it 7 letter. And in one paragraph, on page number 270, in one paragraph, he uses that word 4 times. Four letter word, ing, making it active, describing the activities of Margaret Thatcher, and it goes down the throat of the Britishers. Why this biasness? An American actor uses a four-letter word for Margaret Thatcher's policy, you call for ban. And none of those people who supported Salman Rushdie raised their voice to support that American actor. Why? Why the double policy? Because he uses it 4 times, making it active. And if you read that book, he's used that word 52 times, one for each week. 52 times. I've read the book, therefore I'm saying. And 5 times he's used only that four-letter word. You can make a dictionary out of it. Ing, A, Ing, American, Ing, Allies. All these, you can make a dictionary out of it. And he has even abused the Prime Minister, the ex-Prime Minister, who was the Prime Minister at that time. And he says that, and he calls it a nickname, like he does for all the characters. He is called the Chamcha. He soponifies himself as Chamcha or as the Jibril or Spoonu. He calls Margaret Thatcher Maggie. And what he says, torture. You know what the meaning of torture? Torture means Thatcher. He says torture and full stop. One word sentence, Beautiful. I do appreciate Salman Rushdie for his pen. One word sentence, touch your full stop. Maggie the five letter word. I don't want to repeat it. It's a female dog. He says, touch your full stop. Maggie the five letter word. That's right, I'm answering the question, brother. Because she said that she wants me to throw some light on the satanic verses and on the verdict of Salman Rushdie. Regarding the verdict, it remains the same as my previous answer. Regarding throwing light, I'm throwing light, brother. If you give me the permission, just a couple of more minutes. So that, how many of you out here knew all this was mentioned in the satanic verses? Oh, very good. Two, three. So I'm three. So did you know all this was mentioned? Do you know torture referred to Thatcher? Oh, very good. We have intelligent people out here, but the masses don't know. So, fine. Please let me answer, brother. Let me answer. I do agree that people will say that Margaret Thatcher, she's an iron lady. She won't get moved. She's very strong. I do agree. Even if you call her that five-letter word, even if you call her a female dog, she won't get moved. But imagine if you go to her son, Mark Thatcher. You might have seen him on TV playing soccer, that rugby. If you go to Mark and say, Mark, Salman Rushdie has called you an SOB, son of a five-letter word, I'm sure Mark will hammer you. He will not believe in freedom of speech. If you tell Mark that Salman Rushdie has called you an SOB, son of a five-letter word, he will surely hammer you. Even the British people are sensitive, but their sensitivism is, everyone has different levels of sensitivism. Some people may be sensitive in particular word. Like, for example, if you go on the road, brother, people on the roadside, they keep on abusing each other. Mark your par, bhin ke upar, the same word which Salman Rushdie has used in his. Imagine he uses Hindi word, bane and four-letter word. So, if those people, if you abuse that pie, he's not sensitive at all because he's used to abuse. But if you call him in a very plain language, which is less insulting than the abuse, and tell that maybe your mother is a prostitute, even that roadside man will feel bad. He will feel hurt. Every man is sensitive depending upon his individual field. And the British government, which calls for freedom of speech, it does not believe in freedom of speech. Because when Sheikh Jidad said that give me 5 minutes on the BBC to quote only the verses that Salman Rushdie has said, and I will give £50,000 to any charitable organization, they refused. ABC, American Broadcasting Corporation, they refused. He said, I will pay $50,000 only to quote. You believe in freedom of speech? I will quote Salman Rushdie's book, give you $50,000. They didn't agree. This is as far as freedom of speech goes. And regarding the verdict, sister, the answer is same as I gave for Taslima Nasreen.
I'd like to say something, and very briefly. As I said earlier, the fatwa of Khomeini is inexcusable. If it could be revoked, or rather it could be revoked, as that recent news item said, about 5 years later now, since this thing, it could have been revoked 5 weeks later. But it has not been revoked because of political reasons. That's the first thing, as I keep on insisting. In many of these religious quarrels, look for the political angle in it. That's the first. Secondly, I don't think that Rushdie himself is entirely to be excused either. He has deliberately adopted what I would call a very Western, arrogant position. Now, if you believe in freedom of speech without responsibilities, be ready to take the reaction from wherever. So instead of going underground, I would have said, with all your money, stand up and be counted. If I abuse you in public, I should be prepared for a kind of reaction from you and not go underground. The very government that he abused earlier is the one that is protecting him. I think there's a great anomaly over here, but realize that there's no logic in these matters. Realize, for one thing, that there is, in the Anglo-Saxon world particularly, a growing feeling that militant Islam, in the Islamic fundamentalism, has now taken the place as enemy number one after the death of communism. Communism is no longer now any kind of military threat. Instead, it is now militant Islam. You know all these things from the Gulf War, you know, Iran, and so on and so forth. And that's why, as I said a little earlier, you must understand that a lot of fundamentalism comes from, firstly, a certain vision of society which is not shared by a Western secular ethos. Secondly, that a lot of countries in West Asia particularly are reacting to a lot of Western arrogance and reacting to a post-colonial epoch, whereas they would like to stand on their feet as independent nations and realize that they can't. Even the rich Arab countries cannot. You know that, for the matter of fact. So understand that a lot of these gut reactions to Rushdie as a symbol, or George Bush as another symbol, or Israel as another symbol, all these things come in a vast and very complicated global scenario in which now Islamic fundamentalism is the latest whipping boy, which earlier, for example, it would have been Russia, the Soviet bloc, and so on. Enough.
This is positively the last question. Yeah.
Yeah, you can.
We've been talking largely about Tasneema, and I think it's a little out of proportion. Because last year in Bombay, we had a situation when the Illustrated Weekly of India published an article about Shivaji. And the Times of India was kind of apologized. My question is that copies of the Times of India were born through the threat of suppression of freedom of expression in a different fashion. It was imminent threat. In some sense, are we not living in a self-curtailed sort of parental fantasy state in India, with Shivaji, who was not a religious hero, for example, may have become one, and in numerous other examples. Whereas obviously the Tasneema case are more glamorous and also more violent because of the death threat. Isn't this top-level Maharashtra papers even supported the action saying that Shivaji has to be revealed?
I entirely agree with you, and the point is just this, that if somebody is to be revered, then he has to be put beyond criticism. I don't think we live in a society in which that principle would work. I think everything needs criticism. Everything can be criticized. Why not? Why not? Whether it is religion, whether it's a religious person, whether it's king, or whether it's, I mean, those persons in power, why not? That is freedom of expression.
So if you can allow me, because this question is to Chairman, please.
Chairman,
I want to ask you about.
Yeah.
I hope you are a journalist. This question will be to you.
Okay.
So as Brother Ashok Sahni said, that it is journalists who have put the life of Tasneema Nasreen in problem because of irresponsible behavior. And we see that this journalist, they often do irresponsible things. So what is the punishment to such irresponsible journalists in your society of journalists? Because of their irresponsibility, many problems are created in this country. So what punishment is there for those type of people in your society of journalists?
I am a journalist by profession, but here I am a chairman, and chairman always says no comment. So that is my reply. Anyone, is there to be a vote of thanks, or what is the procedure now? Pardon? What about the one last question on karma, because I think now being Indians, you know, we are so fond of karma, it's better to end with yes, last, positively last.
मेरा निवेदन ये है कि हिंदू धर्म शास्त्र में दलित नाम का कोई शब्द नहीं है. ये अंग्रेजों का दिया हुआ डिप्रेस्ड का अनुवाद के रूप में चल पड़ा है. हमारे यहाँ भाइयों के समान एक बड़ा भाई एक छोटा भाई, अग्रज और अंत्यज, ये शब्द हमारे यहाँ चल रहे हैं. अब रही बात ये कि उनका क्या कर्म है, माने आप अगर ये जानना चाहें ब्राह्मणों क्षत्रियों वैश्यों शूद्रों इन सब के अलग अलग क्या कर्म होते हैं, तो मैं संक्षेप में इतना ही कहूँगा कि कुछ धर्म या कुछ कर्म ऐसे हैं जो मानव मात्र के लिए समान हैं. धृति क्षमा दमह अस्तेयम शौचम इंद्रिय निग्रह, इस प्रकार के मनु के बटलाए हुए कुछ धर्म ऐसे मानव मात्र के समान हैं. फिर कुछ कर्म ऐसे होते हैं जो एक एक व्यक्ति के लिए अलग अलग हो सकते हैं. वो एक एक व्यक्ति के लिए अलग अलग कर्म हो सकते हैं, उनको कृपा करके आप इस दृष्टि से नहीं देखें कि ये छोटा है या ये बड़ा है, ये अच्छा है या ये बुरा है, ये सम्मानजनक है या अपमानजनक है. समाज के धारण के लिए सभी के सभी कर्म परम आवश्यक होते हैं. समाज के धारण के लिए कोई कर्म ऐसा नहीं है जो अनावश्यक हो या जिसको हम छोटा या अपमानजनक समझें. एक बात मैं और कहना चाहूँगा, मैं एक वैद्य हूँ, किसी भी हॉस्पिटल में, किसी भी दवाखाने में, मैं केवल 2-3 मिनट लूँगा, किसी भी हॉस्पिटल में या किसी भी दवाखाने में ये व्यवस्था नहीं होती कि पेशेंट जाए और अपने आप दवा चुन ले। सब जगह यह होता है कि पेशेंट को जाकर किसी डॉक्टर के सामने अपने को पेश करना पड़ता है, डॉक्टर उसका निदान करता है और वो उसको बतलाता है कि तुम इस दवा से अच्छे होगे, ये दवा तुम लो। हिंदू धर्म में ठीक यही व्यवस्था है। हमारे यहाँ जो आप अपने मन से जो करना चाहें वो आप कर लें, वो आपके लिए धर्म हो जाएगा और उसका आपको अच्छा फल मिल जाएगा, ये नहीं हो सकता। आपके लिए क्या कर्म है ये आपका धर्मशास्त्र आपको बतलाएगा, वो कर्म करने पर ही आपको अच्छा फल मिलेगा। इसमें जिसको बंधन लगता हो, इसमें जिसको अपमान लगता हो, इसमें जिसको धर्मशास्त्र के प्रति द्वेष उत्पन्न होता हो, मेरी दृष्टि से वे गलती पर हैं, वे भूल कर रहे हैं। क्योंकि अगर वैद्य के नाते फिर मैं एक उदाहरण दूंगा, मेरे पास चार रोगी आते, एक को मैं गोली देता हूं, एक को काढ़ा देता हूं, एक को मैं कड़वी दवा देता हूं, एक को मैं चाटने की चौना जैसी मीठी चीज दे देता हूं। अगर जब तक मेरी नियत साफ है कि चारों के रोग दूर करने के लिए मैं प्रयत्न कर रहा हूं, जिसका रोग गोली से दूर होगा उसको गोली देता हूं, जिसका काढ़े से होगा उसको काढ़ा देता हूं, जिसको च्यवनप्राश से होगा उसको च्यवनप्राश देता हूं, जब तक मेरी नियत साफ है मैं सबको अच्छा करना चाहता हूं, तब तक आप मुझ पर पक्षपात का आरोप नहीं लगा सकते कि उसको आपने चाचन दिया और मुझको काढ़ा क्यों दे रहे हैं। मेरी नियत खराब हो तो आप दोष लगा सकते हैं, धर्मशास्त्र या ईश्वर की नियत में हम कोई खराबी नहीं मान सकते। इसलिए किसका कल्याण किस कर्म से होगा ये ईश्वर और उनके बाद ऋषियों ने जो हमें बताया है उस पर विश्वास करने से ही हमारा कल्याण हो सकता है। मनमाना हम कुछ कर्म करके ये चाहें कि हमारा कल्याण हो जाएगा तो वैसे ही होगा कि आप एक ऐसा हॉस्पिटल खोल दीजिए, सब दवाइयाँ पड़ी हैं, रोगी आए कोई भी दवा ले और चला जाए, क्या परिस्थिति होगी आप सोच लीजिए। मैंने आप मेरे भी पूछ रहे मैं उस कर्म को जी इस प्रश्न का उत्तर मैं देने को तैयार हूँ। उसके बारे में एक चीज जान लूंगा कि क्या आपने मेरे बारे में जान रखा है कि मैं कौन से कर्म करता हूँ या नहीं करता। दूसरा ये कि ये जानने मान लीजिए एक बात मैं बता दूं, अगर मैं उन कर्मों को ठीक से कर रहा हूँ तो मेरा कल्याण होगा, अगर मैं उन कर्मों को ठीक से नहीं कर रहा हूँ तो मेरा अकल्याण होगा। इससे ज्यादा जानकर आप या ये सभा क्या करेगी। वैसे मैं बता दूं हम लोग आस्तिक एक मिनट केवल आस्तिक होने का दावा करते हैं, हम ये क्लेम करते हैं कि हम धर्मशास्त्रों के एक एक अक्षर पर विश्वास करते हैं और अधिक से अधिक पालन करने का प्रयत्न करते हैं। 100% पालन करने का दावा मैं समझता हूँ इस युग में कोई नहीं कर सकता, पर मैं व्यक्तिगत रूप से अधिक पालन करने का प्रयत्न करता हूँ, ये आश्वासन आपको देना चाहता हूँ। ब्राह्मण के धर्म है यज्ञ करना, यज्ञ कराना, अध्ययन करना, अध्यापन करना, दान और प्रतिग्रह, छह कर्म जो ब्राह्मण के बताए गए हैं उन सबको मैं अपनी ओर से अधिक प्रयत्न करके कर रहा हूँ, ये मैं आपको विश्वास दिला देता हूँ। पर यदि मैं नहीं कर रहा हूँ तो मेरा दोष है, हिंदू धर्मशास्त्र का नहीं, इसका फल मुझे मिलेगा, हिंदू धर्मशास्त्र को नहीं और किसी को नहीं। मैं समझता हूँ इतने से आपको संतोष होना चाहिए।
दिस इज पॉजिटिवली द लास्ट क्वेश्चन
टू डॉक्टर जाकिर नायक। इट इज बीन कोटेड बाय तस्लीमा नसरीन that woman is your tilt, you may go as you like. Do you like to have give any comment on this? Thank you.
I do agree that Taslima Nasreen, and I've read the controversial column in which she has mentioned that in the Quran it is mentioned that the women are the tilt. Sorry, it is not the tilt. She has not mentioned that. That's what the Quran mentioned. She has mentioned that for the husband, the woman is the farmland, not the tilth. The Quran mentions the tilth, but it is approximately the same meaning. She has mentioned that it is mentioned in the Quran. She does not give the reference that for the husband, the wife is the farmland and you can approach them when you like. Along with that, she has said that the women are considered as properties. And she quotes the Quran and saying Surah Imran, that the woman, the gold, everything are possession, the woman, the children, the gold and horses are the possession. Again, she is misquoting. She did not give the complete quotation. She was referring to Surah Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 14, which says that the woman and sons and the gold and silver and the horses branded for excellence and the farmland are possessions which a man is proud of. Which man is not proud of a good wife? Quran says woman, including wife and daughters and son. Which father is not proud of his son? Which
husband should not be proud of his wife, and which wife should not be proud of the husband if he's good. So where is Quran talking that as though they're properties? And regarding the first question, that Quran mentions that the women are as farmlands, she does not give the quotation. Where are you going to find in the full Quran, where is it mentioned in the Quran that wives are considered as farmland? She is referring to Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 223. But for the exact answer, you'll have to refer to the previous verse, Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 222, and then come to 223. Verse number 222 quotes that when they ask thee concerning menstrual periods, I'm quoting the Quran, you can check it up. Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 222. When they ask thee concerning menstrual periods, tell them it's the hurt and pollution. So do not approach your wife during the period. Approach them after they're clean. And any doctor will tell you that if you have intercourse during menstrual periods, it will hurt the wife. And besides that, it will cause certain diseases. It will be harmful for the wife as well as for the husband. So Quran is very scientifically based, telling do not approach your wife when during the menstrual courses. And then the verse continues. The next verse, Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 223 says that your wives are like the tilth. Approach your tilth when you like, and approach them in the way Allah has ordained you. Quran is saying, don't approach in the time of the menstrual period. Otherwise, you have to be good to them whenever like, you can approach them whenever they like, they can approach you. So what is the harm in that? She misquotes, as though women are like property. This verse is linked with the earlier verse talking about should wife be approached during menstrual period, and the Quran says no, it's a hurt and pollution for both. Hope that answers the question, brother.
Friends, we had a very interesting... Oh, I think we had enough. I think we should stop now.
Speech has said that if anybody follows secularism, there will be a problem. He is representing Sanatan Dham. That means you want to say Sanatan Dham by the very nature is fundamentalist?
No, I can't allow this question because it's already way past time. So we all sit... Well, since the learned...
My request to chairman is...
But make it a very brief answer.
That just we are talking about freedom of expression, there should be freedom of questioning also. Please repeat your question.
If you follow secularism, you won't be able to solve any problem. That means you are representing Sanatan Dham. That means with the opinion or the view of Sanatan Dham, you want to say that by the very nature, Sanatan Dham is fundamentalist. That means you want to go against secularism. Then how can you blame Muslim fundamentalism?
There are three parts of this question. Firstly,
2 minutes,
whether...
2 minutes per part.
All right. 2 minutes per part. Thank you. I thought 2 minutes for the whole question. Firstly, the secularism... The anti-word for secularism is not fundamentalism. The anti-word for secularism is theism. To believe in God, to believe in the world hereafter, to believe in the principle that whatever we are doing here, we have to answer somewhere. This is the against principle against the secularism. So if we accept this principle, there will be solution for all problems. If you don't accept this thing, then problems will not be solved. I never said that fundamentalism is the solution for all the questions. Part one. Part two. I never criticize the Muslim fundamentalism in the way it's being done. If Dr. Zakir Naik is correct, the way in which he put the principles, that fundamentalism means that we should have faith and we should have knowledge of the fundamental principles of Islam and we should follow and practice it, then I 101% agree with him. This type of fundamentalism is always welcome. The unfortunate part is that many times every good thing is being misused. We should always know what is being misused. Whether Islam is misused, fundamentalism of Islam is being misused, or it is some whether it is used properly or it is being misused. Anything, even God can be misused. Even God can be misused. So the responsibility is of the person who is misusing the fundamentalism or misusing the religion. It's not the religion which is a block. It's not the fundamentalism in this definition which is a block. It is the misuse of religion, and misuse of what will not be blocked. Misuse of democracy, you are knowing what is happening. Misuse of secularism, you are knowing what is happening. And what was the third part of your question? Is it covered? Are you satisfied?
Yes, we are all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming for this program. Thank you very much for attending.
Yeah.